today we'll talk about we will talk about corneal collagen cross linking. I have no financial interest in this topic. I would like to say that cross linking is not a recent issue. It was first mentioned by Dr. Foot in 1968, who is the first doctor to discuss or talk about biological food oxidation and biological system. And then in 1988, Dr. Fujimori first to discuss the food oxidation of the collagen and its cross-linking by ozone or ultraviolet. In cornea, Dr. Sperl first discussed the cornea cross-linking in porcine eyes on 1998. And Dr. Bolenzak first conducted the pilot study in human using riboflavin and ultraviolet A in 2003. And the cross-linking was approved by FDA 4 years ago. Basic principle of cross-linking, as we know, collagen plays a very supportive role in various human tissue. The intermolecular cross-linking between collagen monomers help to strengthen the structure of the collagen. In human cornea, we have three processes of cross-linking: enzymatic, glycation, and oxidation. In the enzymatic process, it is a part of normal maturation of collagen fibrils. Hello? Do you hear me?
Yes,
hello? Yes, okay. It's a normal maturation of collagen process. The end of collagen fibril has lysine and hydroxylysine amino acid. Enzyme lysine oxidase would catalyze this residues into aldehyde group, which then react with the lysine and the hydroxylysine residues inside the triple helix. And it will form at bivalent and trivalent bonds. As we see in this diagram, the black dots is an collagen molecules, and the gray one is a collagen fibril. As we see, there's a bond intermolecular and interfibrillar between the fiber with tiny, or between collagen. This is a proteoglycan, the core proteins. Between proteoglycan and proteoglycans, we said interproteoglycans. And the interproteoglycans. And as we see, these bonds will strengthen the collagen fiber in after cross-linking. Glycation, it is a non-enzymatic mechanism or process, which bond in glycation, there is a bond between sugar and the amino acid. And this is called the Millard or Browning reaction, in which pentosidine is advanced glycation end product, which are able to form a covalent bond between arginine and the lysine residues. This mechanism occur especially in diabetic patient and to less extent in with aging. But glycation result in damage to the collagen fiber. As we see in this diagram, collagen molecules become non-functioning and contribute to sign of premature or aging. In oxidation, we have some free radicals called reactive oxygen species. It's generated by ultraviolet light and then mediates a process of converting monomers into cross-linking polymers. Oxygen needs to be present in this reaction and in large amount. As we see in this diagram, we have an ultraviolet radiation. It activates riboflavin to have reactive oxygen species or oxygen radical. Oxygen radical would help to cross-linking collagen fibril with the other collagen fibril. As we see in this, this is a corneal donor. The yellow one is cross-linked, and the white one is not linked, cross-linked. As we see, this is a flaccid, and the other is more rigid and resist. What is the indication of corneal cross-linking? Corneal dictatic disorder like keratoconus, pellucid margin degeneration, keratic tegia after refractive surgery, pain relief in bullous keratopathy, and in microbial keratitis, ulcer, and corneal ulceration. Cross-linking donor, الناس اللي أنا عامل لهم corneal graft, عامل cross-linking للgraft ده, يعني it reduce or prevent intraoperative astigmatism, it reduce or prevents astigmatism, more في نفس الوقت at the same time more resistant to degeneration by collagenetic enzymes. We have the first protocol EPOF for corneal cross-linking. This was introduced in Dresden University by Dr. Bolenzak in 2003. In sterile condition, I remove about 8 to 9 millimeter of seconary epithelium, and I use riboflavin 0.1%, index trend 20%, for 30 minutes, 2 drops for every 2 minutes. Then I expose by ultraviolet A. After 30 minutes of instillation, a radiation of ultraviolet A of 3,017 nanometer of ultraviolet A, or 3 milliwatt per square centimeter, applied for 30 minutes. لازم هنا يبقى عندنا minimum corner thickness about more than 400 micron after debridement of the epithelium. For the safety of the corneal endothelium. But the time is money, as we know. One of the most drawback of this maneuver is time. This is a lengthy maneuver because I used to one hour for each eye. So we have a recent modification or variation in this protocol to have the same effect. According to the laws of reciprocity, which states that the effect of photochemical or photobiological reaction is direct proportional to the total irradiation dose irrespective of the time span over which the dose is administered. ومن هذا جاء بدأ يجي لنا يظهر حاجات جديدة منها accelerated cross linking. Accelerated cross linking بيعتمد depend on إن هو أن أنا بوصل بدل ما أدي العيان 3 ملي وات ببدأ أزود increase الدوز من 3 ل 9 ل 18 ل 36 ل 90 ملي وات. As we see في الديجرام كل ما بزود الدوز كل ما بقلل التايم لحد انا ما بوصل لل 90 ملي وات على السنتيمتر المربع بتوصل 1 مينت. الاكسلريتد كروس لينكينج significantly shortens the time and reduces the patient discomfort. Moreover, the ultraviolet radiation time is significantly lower. It avoids excessive corneal thinning and subsequent endothelial damage intraoperative or postoperative. لكن في بقى الناس الاجنس الموضوع as we know ان you have a shallow demarcation line. Yeah, the patient which you had accelerated cross linking had a shallower demarcation line. What is the demarcation line? Demarcation line that represents the transitional zone between the anterior cross linking stroma and the posterior untreated stroma. وهم بيقولوا ان الناس الاجنسيس تكنيك بيقولوا ان ده كده بيبقى less efficiency of the technique.
يا دكتور عمرو I'm sorry we have audience from outside Egypt, please stick to English language because
okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay, since the anterior stromal fibers attribute to the majority of the biomechanical strengths, a shallower or demarcation line may still provide adequate or to prevent disease progression. We have another protocol, it's called the pulsed cross-linking. In pulsed cross-linking, we use 1 second on and 1 second off as compared to accelerated continuous ultraviolet irradiation. We have in this technique a deeper demarcation line, and but the exact duration of the pulse is still a question that remains unanswered. Up till now, we don't know for how long we can go on and how many seconds to be off. 1 second, 2 seconds, these are on this issue is under debate. Trans-epithelial cross-linking, if you on, as we introduced to prevent the adverse effect of associated with epithelial debridement as well as possible role in thinner cornea, the administration of the riboflavin and the dexitran solution on intact corneal epithelium. This technique, it avoid or reduce the most important drawback of epi-off, which is pain, haze, and infection. But the issue, we remove the lipophilic epithelium would facilitate the penetration of hydrophilic riboflavin molecule through the epithelium. Thus, one would assume that the cross-linking effect of trans-epithelium cross-linking would be lower compared to epithelial off technique. While hazard, so we use some enhancers like tetracaine 1% or sodium chloride 0.4% or benzalkonium chloride 0.02% and 0.04%. This facilitates trans-epithelium riboflavin stromal absorption. Another protocol, which is called trans-epithelial cross-linking, and it's called iontophoresis cross-linking. It is a non-invasive technique that allows transepithelial riboflavin penetration following application of mild electrical current. They assume that this mild electrical current facilitate and help penetration of riboflavin to the corneal stroma. Cross-linking in thin cornea, standard resident protocol mandate a minimal corneal thickness for 400 of micron following epithelial debridement. But in some, in practice, we can find a lot of patients who have a thin cornea. And if we consider removal of the epithelium, which can be calculated to 50 micron, we can find the total thickness of the epithelium in this patient is very thin. So what we can do? We can use hypoosmolar riboflavin by concentration 0.05% to increase the corneal hydration and the thickness intraoperative. And we not allow to be more than 80 micron. We can use customized pachymeter guided epithelial debridement. We can use a riboflavin soaked contact lens too, but we should use a contact lens with that. We have a contact lens ultraviolet protection. We must use a contact lens without ultraviolet protection. We also use refractive lenticule for if we have smile technique in previous in the same day, we can use the refractive lenticule soaked with the riboflavin and put in the cornea of the patient. And we can use hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose riboflavin to prevent the corneal hydration. Also, we can use customizing ultraviolet irradiation to stromal thickness is an evolving technique used and customizing ultraviolet irradiation in which I can irradiate the cornea by ultraviolet in some area and the other area with thin cornea I don't irradiate. We have a new technology which is called high fluency cross-linking. It is an emerging and evolving concept in which it offers a non-incisional, non-ablative treatment. That approach involving high fluency irradiation of ultraviolet A to induce subsequent flattening and refractive correction. This is a transepithelial maneuver, and they assume that up till now, this maneuver or this technique can correct from -3 diopter to +1 diopter, and it will be promising in the future. Scleral cross-linking for axial myopia, for progressive myopia, in which use photosensitizer and the blue light to mechanically reinforce the sclera, maybe prevent the progression of such cases. And what's called the PEG cross-linking, in which, as we know, ultraviolet irradiation has a known antimicrobial effect. Also, riboflavin, when photoactivated, is when it has a microcidal effect. So a combination of post-produced cytotoxic effects. So infectious cornea resistant to therapy, excluding herpetic keratitis, especially bacteria and Acanth amoeba were superior to fungal keratitis. So I can use cross-linking to treat resist corneal, bacterial corneal ulcers, especially Acanth amoeba, and then fungal, and to less extent, we must include herpetic infection, because it activates the herpes. What is the complication of cross-linking? One of the most important complication of cross-linking is persistent corneal haze. Persistent corneal haze, it occurs peak 1 month, and then it reaches a plateau after 3 months, and then it improves from 6 to 20 months. The haze of cross-linking after cross-linking is located in deeper in the stroma and has a dust-like appearance. What is the cause of it? It may be due to the repopulation of the activated keratocyte after the immediate loss of the keratocytes following cross-linking. What is the most important post-operative complaint of the patient of the corneal haze? Endothelial damage and the corneal edema. Cross-linking is not recommended, as we said, for the corneal less than 400 micron. But we can face endothelial damage and the corneal edema even we have not thin cornea. And why? Several mechanisms have been proposed, like inaccurate measurement of corneal thickness, inadvertent delivery of the energy due to the machine. We use a non-calibrated machine or old machine, corneal dehydration during the procedure, poor focusing of the light source of the cornea, and endothelial disease, life force endothelial dystrophy. Post optive nightmare corneal infection, and we have many predisposing factors like debridement of the epithelium, use of the contact lenses, and use of the steroid. And all of this is a risk factor for infection, bacterial infection. Striated corneal infiltration, and we must differentiate striated corneal infiltration from corneal abscess or infection, bacterial corneal infection. In striated corneal infiltration, after cross-linking, there are some ring-like infiltrated after cross-linking, which resolve completely after the instillation of the topical steroid. This is a very, very difference in treatment. In this cases, will improve by steroid, and the bacterial infection will be aggravated by steroid. Herpetic keratitis after LASIK, as we know, it has been shown that exposure to the ultraviolet light can reactivate latent herpes simplex virus infection. The epithelial debridement, the damage to the corneal nerve itself activates the virus. Use of the topical steroid post-operative may be proposed a risk factor. Other complications like failure treatment, excessive corneal flattening with hyperbaric shift of endothelial failure, corneal melting, especially with atopic eye patient, and permanent stromal scar. Now we have a cross-link combined with other treatment we called cross-linking plus, like cross-linking with topography-guided PRK with mitomycin, which is called the ASIM protocols. Protocol, we can do a semi-altenous or subsequential cross-linking with PTK, is called Cretin protocol, cross-linking with corneal rings, which is sequential or semi-actinous, cross-linking plus topic ICL. And we have LASIK extra. In LASIK extra, combined LASIK improves the quality of vision, but reduce the biomechanic strength of the cornea, which could be partially or completely compensated by cross-linking. And use this technique, LASIK extra, in high refractive error and in patients with thin corneas. Induce long-term, but one of its complication, it induce long-term flattening and maybe result in overcorrection or hyperbaric shift. Also, both the cross-linking stromal haze can further deteriorate the vision quality. How can I use a LASIK extra technique? I use high concentration of riboflavin, 0.25%. And use it for 90 seconds, and then I on the interface, and I wash it, and I use ultraviolet irradiation with high energy, 30 milliwatt for per squared centimeter, to have accelerated cross-linking. There is another combination for treatment, three treatment like cross-linking plus ring corneal rings plus PRK, or cross-linking plus ring plus toric IOL. So the home tech message, cross-linking is a still evolving technology whose full potentiality is yet to be realized in technique, indication, and combination. And I think this will be a promising technology in the future. Thank you for all.